tuning in to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hello, AfterBuzzers. You are watching the AfterBuzz TV After Show for HBO's Looking Season 2, Episode 10, the finale called Looking for Home. I am so excited to say that we have a very special guest on our show with us today, the one and only Daniel Franzese, also known as Eddie. Welcome.
Hey, what's up? It's good to be here.
I'm your host, Kylie Hodges, and my two lovely co-hosts to the left are...
Hi, guys. I'm Blake McIver.
Hey, y'all. I'm Kellie Knezovich.
We are so excited to have you here,
Daniel. Yeah, we are.
Yes, welcome.
Thank you. I am happy to be here.
I feel like I might accidentally call you Eddie at some point, because I'm just, every time I see you, I just keep thinking, Eddie Bear! Eddie, where's Augustine?
Now that you've said it, you've made it a thing.
Yeah. So, Eddie, Daniel, I'm sorry, whatever I call you.
Whatever. What's up, Danny? You know, it's all the same.
At what's up, Danny?
What's up, Danny?
This finale, I don't know how I feel. I truly have a lot of mixed feelings at the end of this episode. How do you guys feel?
It was a big... I actually had a big, like, shift in perspective at the end of this episode.
Interesting.
We'll get into that in a minute. But, yeah, no, I was shocked by how I felt at the end of the episode. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought it was a mess. I had a lot of feelings. I was...
A good mess,
very,
though,
very,
right?
Oh. That was a good mess, yes.
Okay. You guys aren't going to talk crap while I'm here, right?
I guess the show's over.
The only crap I'll be talking is about Kevin, because I'm forever Team Richie.
Hashtag Team Richie.
Half of the internet hates me, because I loved Richie that much.
Well, you kind of got your wish, kind of. I mean,
I don't know. I don't know what I got.
I guess no one really knows.
I don't know what I got.
Yeah. Until we find out in season 3.
This episode is primarily Patrick and Kevin, mm-hmm. because a lot of answers came for you and your character in the previous episode,
right,
where locked it down with Augustine.
Right, yeah, we finally became Augustetti.
Augustetti.
Do you ship
that? Do you ship it?
I ship it hard. I shipped it the minute you were in water.
Yes. The skinny dip. From the skinny dip on, we were in.
You've been waiting
your skin
long time.
Was moist. I was shipping.
So the episode starts where Patrick is moving in with Kevin, mm-hmm. and it seems like it's a fancy building. It reminded me of a downtown LA loft.
Absolutely.
There's just cement everywhere and key fobs for everything.
Yeah.
And he meets his neighbors in the elevator, Jake and Milo. And they seem friendly, they seem fun, and they're all very aware
they
that
seem
he's
very friendly.
Yes, very friendly. And
like
he acknowledges
them.
That. Yeah. Well, this whole building seems like it's a fun place to live.
Yeah.
And so he meets Kevin inside their new unit. And the one thing that stood out to me was when Patrick sees the Field of Dreams poster and he's kind of startled by it.
And I would have been. I'd have been like a little ew.
Because it's huge.
Yeah. Womp womp.
It's literally floor to ceiling.
I know. I mean, no offense. Great movie.
I was going to say.
I'd have been like, in my living room? I don't know.
I don't want to stare at Kevin Costner.
You
want
to give me like a serial mom or a she-devil moment? I'd be like, oh, this guy's cool. But like, Field of Dreams.
Yeah, no, well, snooze, right? to each his own. You got it. Everyone has that one thing, I guess. For Kevin, it's Kevin Costner.
Well, for Kevin, it's a
for
couple
me, it's
of
a futon.
You love futons? Oh, you
no,
hate
I'm
them.
Out. I'm like,
nope.
We're done.
That's your
over.
Yeah. I've been severely anti futons and muggles since. Like,
are you a big Harry Potter fan?
I am. Yeah.
Is that what is like your number one favorite movie? I'm totally derailing this. I'm just curious.
Oh, my favorite. The
yeah,
first
like number one.
Because I was the first one. Because I loved the book so much that I was so stoked that it captured it so well. That I was like, this is going to be a great journey.
If you could be in Harry Potter, which character would you be?
I mean, they'd probably cast me as Hagrid.
But who would you cast cast yourself as?
Halloween. No typecasting. Halloween Hagrid. Okay, let's be honest. Halloween Hagrid. Let's be honest. Okay. Who would I want to be? Mm-hmm. Probably Harry.
Yeah.
Not gonna lie.
Yeah.
He has to like almost die a lot though. I don't know if I would be in.
Yeah. All adventure
sounds scary and painful.
You're like, oh, you guys, it's okay. You can go to the club. I'm just gonna climb some rocks and fall down for another 8 hours. Like knowing the truth behind the scenes, it's probably better off. I was like, oh, maybe I'll just be like Hedwig the Owl or something.
Yeah, just be like the extra drinking butterbeer in all the scenes. That's the best.
I'm the sorting hat. You guys, this was great. This. See you at the premiere.
I wish there was like a looking Harry Potter mashup now. That would be great.
Back to my show.
Yeah. That's my way of transitioning back to the topic.
I'll just do it. And looking. Fobs and dudes that want to hook up.
So what I was getting at the Field of Dreams thing was that I feel like he's moving in with a guy that he really doesn't know that well. And I know that we've talked a lot in past episodes about we don't really know what the timing is for this show. And I don't know, do you have any, want to give any input as to like how that, things
move? Oh, the timing? The timing jumps like, around on the show.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
But you know, what's really interesting is stuff that is so clear in the script. Like, I'm like, oh, I don't know how many people are really going to catch that, you know?
Right.
Like, which I find is really interesting.
Like what?
Well, I don't want to jump further in the episode, but when Kevin shows up on Grindr as Romford, the guy, in, there's a very subtle, he's the closest guy to us. Like, that line that I think, like, people miss. And to me, that read so much in the script because I would have, that would have been the thing that's been like, he's in the room, you know what I mean? Like, whoever this is, and it's on now. Like, and I think that's something I really just love about our show, the subtlety of it. You know, I mean, I've seen each episode probably twice. You know, and because you know they gave them to us in advance to talk to press, and then we get to see them again when they air. And I find out, you know, I'm like, oh, there's that thing, or there's this thing that I found out when I listened to it alone with earphones, you know, on my computer, compared to when I watched it in a room full of people with TV. Like there were things that I was picking up, and that was one of them. You know, that little. But it's same thing with time. Time will jump, but they'll explain it. You know, like in a different way. You know, episode where Patrick's arm's hurt, and then we cut to the next episode, and he's healed, and it's like, it's like, okay, so then there's some time, and then they'll be like, well, that was 2 weeks ago, and you'll be like, oh, okay. You know what I mean? If you're really listening, but I think that we don't sit around all day and say, well, it was exactly 7 days since I saw you last time, you know? Like,
I have did you do all your character work in between? Did you know exactly where you were the day before?
So I think the time jumps are important to notice.
You know, I agree.
In the first episode, we meet at Russian River, right? Me and Augustine. But then he's going to go meet my friend Eddie at the club. Like, we must have texted or saw each other or talked or something. And how much time has passed? It's like, you know, that kind of thing.
Because I think it was, what, 3 or 4 episodes ago? It was the Halloween party. Mm-hmm. Or 5 episodes ago. And then they were talking about moving in together. And it was like, I just want to have Christmas here. And, you know, so then we knew it was, what, a couple months since then. So
yeah. Well, actually, someone tweeted at me over the weekend. And I feel like of all the tweets I've gotten about the timing of the show, this one makes the most sense to me. At Phil Bond said, Pat's mom made a reference to his sister at the zoo that she's been married for about 3 months. So, and Kevin made a comment to Patrick's mom that the last 2 months have not been without drama. So we can guess that they've more or less been dating 2 months by the time they move in together.
See, which, those are the exact type of things that if you really are listening.
Yeah.
I know. That's why it's called looking, because you got to look for the details.
If you were in a relationship like Kevin and Patrick's, would you move in with him after 2 months?
See, I thought we were going to talk about this later on, but But like, I'll go for it. I don't think Patrick's wrong for making that decision.
Okay.
I think whenever it comes to matters of the heart, you have to take a leap. And what's going to happen with that is you might get hurt, and that's the risk that you're taking in order to get the great reward.
I like that.
I just don't know if it was with the right guy. You know, as we saw, maybe for him, you know, because Kevin, everyone's got somebody. But in that moment, I don't think that Patrick was wrong for saying, okay, I'm going to try this, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't give up his place, so.
No, that's smart. Yeah. Always have a backup.
Always have a backup. Always have an exit strategy.
Always have your apartment.
Yes, never give up that apartment.
And that way they can go, and you can even go and have your 2 days just off.
Get right to Grindr abort mission, you know? But, like, slowly, like, no. Yeah.
I've throughout this whole series, I feel like I've always been very protective in like a motherly way towards Patrick, and so that's kind of my reasoning why I'm not anti-Kevin, but I see a lot of red flags. And so, like you're saying, just listen to your heart and, you know, if it feels right, go for it.
My mother says something completely different. My mom should be on this panel, really.
Yeah. That's what we should call her.
No, but she literally is like, I need to sit Patrick down and tell him, stay away from that Kevin. Like, from, like, the beginning. Moms know, you know?
Yeah.
But sometimes, you know, you get a little, I don't know, I guess he's a little dickmatized or something.
Life wouldn't be as interesting if you always went the safe route, too. You know, I mean,
he's changed so much, though, since the first episode of the first season. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, he's getting there. He's growing.
But he's been longing for, like, this search of, you know, there's a great, I'm going to totally paraphrase this, but there was a great article that came out in the New Yorker about Looking that I just read that was just so interesting, that was saying that, like, you know, Patrick's too old to have taken a boy to prom, but, like, too young to have dealt with a lot of the drama of the crisis, you know, and things like that. Mm. So it's sort of like he's in this weird place where he wants to find something and doesn't know what it is and can't find it. No, too young to deal with, to be dreaming of the gay utopia. And mm-hmm. That's what it was. And he's like in that place that I think, you know, I'm 36. I kind of feel similar to that, you know, in a lot of ways, just where his place fits in the gay landscape. And I think that that's a common problem that, you know, it's like, okay, you're gay, great, we all accept it, you know, and now what? You know, and then it's like, well, now what do I need? And I think that, you know, it's interesting how naive he is a lot of the time. But I know a lot of people that way.
Yeah. So do you feel like there's some sort of, are you saying that maybe, like, before you're out, you think that all these things are going to change after you're out, and then once you're out, it's like, okay, I'm out, now what?
Well, you know, he's a video game designer, he lives in San Francisco. Like, I think that a lot of people think I'm interesting, and I'm moving to this interesting place, and my life, therefore, will be interesting. Like, the city and the people will take me to what it has to be. And then, all of a sudden, when you start searching for that thing, that so many problems arise from that. Because, ultimately, when you're comfortable with yourself and you just be, things do arise. But I think that Patrick's, you know, floundering a lot because he's still trying to figure out what his place is in all of it. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think that's part of his story that I find so interesting.
That's such a quarter-life crisis type feeling.
Completely. Whereas like Eddie, my character, has been through it and has seen a bunch of stuff and has dealt with everything. He knows exactly who he is, where he stands. You know, won't take Augustine's BS because he hears it from the kids at the shelter all the time and all this other stuff. So he just sort of knows exactly where he is. He's like planted. Mm-hmm. You know, Patrick's somebody that's like not. He has some life to him. He's growing in some places, but in other places, like, he's still, like, you know, a seedling.
Would you describe him as immature?
Emotionally immature in some ways. I wouldn't think of him as an immature man, sure. But I think of him, like, emotionally, he's got some things that still are underdeveloped.
Yeah.
I mean, at least in my opinion.
So then when it comes to this episode, when they're in the party and they realize that this could possibly be, like, a swingers party.
Right.
Is it that Patrick is naive, or that he's just too young to fully grasp it? Or is it, I mean, I would have reacted the same as him if I was at a party and realized, like, oh, this is a key swap.
Like, let's see enough for it to start going down, and then we'll make her
exit.
We'll sneak out to the, you know, mural party.
Yeah. It's just funny. I thought it was funny how, like, I feel like Kevin played it way cooler when they realized that it was, like, and Patrick was just kind of like,
well, look at Patrick in the episode, the Halloween episode, where he's, you know, I'm gonna be a fun gay, you know, it's this whole thing about, like, well, people who are fun don't go, like, let's be fun today. You know,
let's get together and just be fun.
You know what I mean? Like, in a lot of ways. And it seems like he's always searching for that kind of mentality. And I think also in the Russian River, he was like, let's just do fun things where we're sitting around and playing board games and whatever. And so here's an opportunity where, in his new relationship, in his new life, he's just like, I'll stay. You know, he's like, instead of, like, outwardly saying it, he's just trying to just go with the flow and be fun, because I think he feels freer now that he's, like, in this relationship, you know, before it blew up on him.
Yeah, I was gonna say, and then it's about to blow up.
Bum, bum, bum.
So he's at the party and he hears Milo and Jake, and they're on Grindr, and they say, what is it, Rumford? Is that the
Romford, which is where
the
he's
town
from.
We grew up in. Yep. And so you see the look on Patrick's face, immediately process it and go, "Holy shit! I think that's Kevin." He leaves the party. He confronts Kevin, and Kevin gets around to admitting that he had Grindr open on his phone. How would you guys feel if this happened to you?
Okay, here's the first problem. But Patrick, strike one.
Okay.
He goes from 0 to 60 yes. before asking the first question.
And the first question would be, are you on Grindr?
Yes.
Okay.
Or any of the leading questions. But right. he goes immediately emotional. So, right. like, first reaction, overreaction.
Right.
Like... it's too much.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you love the guy loves you. Like, you're trying to make it work. You ask the question first before you get, like, emotionally invested. Kelly?
Wow. Dr. Phil over here.
Yeah, I was going to say, you just gave me a lot to think about.
Because I would have done that.
I think I probably would have as well, because it's just something you don't expect. And I think I don't think Patrick expected it. I think Patrick assumed that they were exclusive. Which, to be honest, as a viewer watching the show, I did as well. They never had that talk. And we didn't really understand. As much as Kevin says, I want to be with you, that doesn't mean I want to be exclusive with you. That just means, hey, like, I want to be boyfriends.
Or the gray area of what that means for the both of them.
Like,
all of
that. Yeah.
Because Kevin may say, I want to be with you. And Kevin knows damn well what that means. But Patrick's like, oh, you want to be with me? You know, it's like, it's like you said, gray area. There's nobody's really talked about the specifics yet. And then they get to this situation. And it's a mess. And I got really stressed out.
What do you think?
That fight that they had was so impassioned. I mean, that's conversations in all different aspects, all different sexualities that people have had with, yes. you know, I do think you should have done a little more research. I mean, to me, like, if you meet a guy in a situation like where they're cheating, that, you know, then you have to be wary about a lot of things and ask a lot of questions, a lot of more questions than normal. But this just goes back to Patrick's lack of experience.
Yeah.
You know, and he's learning all the tough lessons in front of us, which is really embarrassing for him. You know,
but it's good.
He has no idea we're all watching.
Bless his heart. Bless his heart.
But it's so true. I mean, if I found out that my boyfriend had Tinder on his phone, I would be irate. But I would have also assumed it didn't need to be a conversation. He would have just understood that I thought. That's gone now that we are together. We are exclusive. And I bet Patrick did the same thing. He assumed they were on the same page.
Well, the 0 to 60 thing, I mean, he just moved in. I mean,
yeah.
I think that day you need to be on it.
Yeah.
Like, if this happened, like, a month from now, and I'm like, why are you on that? Like, that's weird. Like, you know what I mean?
Right.
But, like, the day, you're like, oh, I'm moving in. Let's see who's, you know, gonna just randomly text me their privates.
But Kevin doesn't have an issue with that, though. Kevin is completely fine with it. That's who he is.
Yeah.
And I was shocked to see that. I was surprised that it was the day that he moved in. You know, I would have figured it would have been like, okay, you know, a couple weeks down the line. Well,
Kevin even said, like, I was waiting
to have this conversation.
Yeah, so I don't think he wanted anybody to...
Well, earlier in the season when Kevin chose John and they had that moment with the spin art party, you know, at the at Most Dangerous Games, and he was like, you know, that's the strongest I've ever seen Patrick. That was like when I was like, wow, Patrick's really... standing up to him, and he's like, well, you made your choice. I don't have to stay at the party, right? I'm not required while I'm going home. Like, I was like, that's like the Patrick that I think has been like slowly creeping through. But then I think the emotional roller coaster of going to Doris's dad's funeral and coming back and you know, being hurt and then like seeing him there and him saying finally, like, you know, I think that just let down a lot of guards that Patrick has been painstakingly building up this whole season, you know, of calluses. That just like were gone, you know, and that's where he probably neglected to ask those questions and like find out that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I just I wasn't surprised that Kevin was on Grindr, but my reaction was like, of course, like I knew that there was going to be something.
Yeah,
that happens with Kevin that would make me like irritated.
It sparked a huge debate in my house. Like,
really?
Yeah, between myself, my boyfriend, and my mother, who were like, you know, they were just like, would you think that's okay? And I'm like, no, I don't think it's okay, but I'm not surprised, like you said, you know? I was like, you know, as soon as I started dating my boyfriend and I knew that I wanted to, like, date him, all of those kind of, like, Tinder and all that were gone, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that's not even a conversation we needed to have. So for me, that's just the type of person I am. And I think that's the type of person Patrick is. But there are different types of people, and there's different rules and stuff like that. And I think they just really needed to sort it out before going all the way through with it.
Yeah. Patrick is also learning that those type of people exist. I think he's always assumed everyone is like him. It's very black and white. You're either dating somebody or you're not dating somebody. There's open relationships didn't seem like an option for him.
Which is bizarre, though, because Dom and Lynn had an open relationship, so he has been exposed to it before.
That's true. But he was never...
But he's never actually been involved in one, yeah.
So then when the fight goes down to the parking ramp, and this is when it's just emotional, and Patrick is crying, and he's telling Kevin... basically, he says, right now I want monogamy, but maybe in 10 years that could change. But right now this is what I want. We never really get an answer from Kevin as to, like, where this leaves them and, like, if...
Cliffhanger.
I mean, I'm like, give me some answers, but you don't know them because there's no season 3, and I'm all worked up right now, and
you know,
I don't know how to deal with this.
One thing I really loved about this conversation that... I felt like it was, like, a 10-minute-long conversation. Mm-hmm. Patrick said something that I feel really struck me, and I'm sure it struck you guys as well. He said, you know, what if you go down to get a bagel? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm going to think that something's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if I've ever personally seen a show where they kind of discuss before someone cheats as opposed to after. I mean, we always see the aftermath of someone cheating. But this kind of discusses the jealousy and the issues that come before the cheating.
Who knows?
The justified paranoia.
Yeah. And would you call it cheating if it's an open relationship?
Not if it's a massage. It doesn't even count if it's a massage.
That's right, my bad. What am I thinking?
Not a wank in the steam room. No, but it's like what it really comes down to is trust at this point. And it's like, and if Patrick can't trust that they're going to be honest about what goes on, and is he even okay if stuff does go on?
That's the thing. I think that Kevin would be honest as to what goes on, but I don't think that he would abide by Patrick's rules. Not that Patrick has rules, but, you know, it wouldn't abide by what Patrick wants. And and I think it kind of comes down to a respect thing, too, perhaps.
Yeah, well, they need to define things. Mm-hmm. They need to define what is a relationship and an open relationship and what is cheating and all of those things. I mean, the whole episode, I was very one-sided and I could only relate to Patrick.
Well, there is that whole group of, like, you know, like the Milo and Jake, like, guys that are into that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And then they moved into that building. And I think Patrick had, like, a Stepford moment where he was like, is everybody?
Everyone's a swinger.
What a world.
It was a lot to process.
Yeah, poor guy. Well, I mean, if anything, his stuff is already in boxes. So if he needs to go.
I like doing the practical assessment.
It's Mama
not
Kylie over
if your
here.
Stuff is in boxes.
No, but if he needs to escape, now's the time to do it.
But back to party fouls on this conversation.
Yes, please,
like,
do.
Strike two.
Okay. Oh, yeah, your strikes.
I'm still thinking about it. Strike two, Kevin literally hands him the phone, and it's like, go ahead, look at pictures that I've potentially sent, messages I've potentially sent. Nothing's there. Look at it. Look through my Grindr history. Like, someone
like
who says that doesn't have anything to hide.
I don't know. I think it's the reverse.
Somebody who says that's pre-planned and deleted.
Exactly.
Manipulative.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
It could be.
Come on, man.
I thought it seemed smart enough to do something.
Why have
like
it?
That.
Yes. Why have
premeditated.
It? Why have it? Like, what's the purpose? To
Thank
see?
You.
He says, don't you want to see what gays are lurking in the shadows? But it's like, who? Why? What do you care? What do you care? We met Jake and Milo. We saw everybody at the party. Like, what? Like, who? Are you going to have a conversation? Are you hoping someone accidentally sends you something?
Yeah.
Like, why?
How many friendships are formed on Grindr? Like, just friendships,
just
you know?
Just looking for friends, guys.
Yeah. I was going to say, I thought it was a friendship app, no?
Yeah, no.
Just friends.
Unless you want to befriend.
I'm sure that happens, but not, especially not with someone with a blank profile. Like, what's going
that's
down?
That's shady. It's so shady.
Yeah, that is really shady.
Thank you.
I'm going to make a Grindr profile tonight that's just going to say femme for femme friends.
Wait, and here's another thing. One thing we really didn't discuss either, which is interesting, is it's not like he had the profile and was single and then didn't get rid of it. He was, like, with John and had the profile and then is coming into a new relationship
still
with the profile.
I forget, did John know, or did they have that conversation?
John didn't know nothing.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So then it makes me wonder, what was he doing when he was still with John but seeing Patrick?
Well, like,
were
there
sides, yeah, you know?
He brought that up, yeah.
Ugh, I'm so bothered.
See,
by
it's
this.
Crazy to me because Condon was so, he was so, he didn't feel any guilt at all.
No.
You know, he was very like, this is who I am. Like, I want to see other people. Well, I want to be with you, but I also want to be able to see other people and hook up with other people. But he wasn't ashamed of it.
No.
He was very confident.
Mm-hmm. And I don't want this to look like an attack on Kevin, because, like, you know,
it's not. I don't even think Kevin's in. I don't know if Kevin's even in the wrong here.
Right. Exactly. It's not that he's in the wrong.
I just think it's like a reevaluation of the match. Mm-hmm. You
yes.
know?
Mm-hmm. And their expectations are just. It seems like they're so skewed. Like, they're not on the same page at all. And there was just a lot of assumptions. Like, Kevin seemed to assume Patrick would be cool with him.
Do you think he did, though? Do you think he assumed it?
I think, well, because now I'm thinking maybe he knew Patrick wouldn't be okay with it, so he was going to introduce it in a,
like, oh, we've already,
in a mellow way.
Here's another thing. Okay, going back to this, the reason I have a problem with this as an outsider, it's like kind of hard to report on my own show. But like,
yeah.
But I feel like he had it on. He was, like, in the room with it on. Like, did he turn it on in the bathroom? Like,
right.
It was, like, he had it on that day since he moved in. It wasn't like, hey, let's turn on Grindr and just see who's gay in the building with your boyfriend.
Yeah, that would be different.
That would be different. Like, but it was, like, on. I mean, it's just weird. Although, in his defense again, it did have Romford, which is, like, so obviously him. It's not like he was trying to hide anything. So it's like there's a lot of like there's a lot of things that we didn't have time to like work out yet.
Yeah. Would he like just do that because he's assuming he would know Patrick would never be on Grindr? I just am trying to figure out how sneaky
Patrick,
he actually
don't
is.
Don't you have it on your phone?
Right.
Oh, you're right. He did. Oh,
so
God.
Many questions, so many assumptions, such lack of trust.
Back to Augustine and Eddie.
Yes. Yeah, I was gonna say I think we've beaten that to the pulp.
That horse is dead.
Yeah. Wait, so Augustine and Eddie, they're at this mural unveiling.
Magic.
Yeah, you're running this show.
My earphones.
And you are rocking the Santa costume.
Yes.
That seems Santa like it's costume. Augustine's thing because he loves it. He wants you in it all the time.
Yeah. I mean, there isn't we're like picking apart every detail of our appearance in this episode. You're like.
But anyway, I mean, it was. I wish there was more of you in this episode, but it was very Patrick and Kevin.
Yes.
But we do see you guys being coupley and kissing at the
end. I know,
event.
Finally, right?
Yeah.
It was a really long build-up. I mean, we didn't kiss for a really long time. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of assumptions I was seeing of people wondering if we did or didn't off camera, you know, because anything that happened in our relationship was off camera. But until we finally, until Eddie and Augustine finally got together. But I think it's such a sweet love story, isn't it?
It is.
I really just loved
so
it.
Sweet.
We loved it.
Yeah.
You know, it was just so fun to, like, let it unfold that way.
Do you see your character moving as fast in a new relationship as, like, the Kevin and Patrick relationship has evolved? Like, they're moving together within 2 months?
I don't even want to say because I already have an idea of where it would go, and I don't even want to go there.
They're married.
Right.
They get married the next season 3,
season 3,
episode 1.
The
marriage of Eddie and Augustine.
Probably not
looking
that far. It took 5 episodes to kiss.
Right.
I'm happy with how we were left off with Eddie and Augustine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so too. Especially, you know, with Augustine using his talents now for something that actually is benefiting things. And I think it's a really good place that he's in. I mean, what a turnaround he did from.
Yeah, he's come a long way.
Augustine's really grown a lot, you know?
Do you feel like Eddie has changed Augustine for the better? It's a little wicked.
I really love it.
He's been changed for good.
For good.
As any good relationship, I think you both change each other.
Yeah.
You know, I think. Eddie also had a lot of walls up that Augustine broke down. So, I think they changed each other. You know, I like to say that scene. I never said it to you guys before that they both had baggage, but they had matching luggage.
It's so true. And it's a great parallel because it's like these two characters are so they're so it's such a symbiotic relationship, so opposite of what we've got with Patrick and Kevin, just sort of tearing each other apart and hitting against all of their damage, their baggage clashes.
Yeah. Now, there's one thing I wanted to ask you about. Augustine makes, like, an excuse about how he doesn't want to do it because he said he's feeling symptoms of PrEP. There's, like, a line where he says, he's like, I don't feel good. I want to dive into that a little bit because I don't know nearly anything at all about prep, and I know some people do. And there's also a lot of people on Twitter I've been seeing commenting on the YouTube videos and stuff. They're like, what is prep?
Let's talk about prep.
As an ambassador for the Elizabeth Taylor Agency.
Yes, that's, I knew you'd be perfect for this.
I do want to talk about that.
Yeah. I can tell you a little bit about it. Prep is a drug that was previously used in the cocktail of drugs for HIV patients for about 10 years now. And so the side effects long-term have been seen, you know, very minimal. Things like queasiness and stuff like that. And for the last year, it has been approved for everyone, straight or gay, as a drug that combined with protected sex, it makes it nearly impossible to transmit HIV. And possible for serodiscordant couples, like mixed status couples, to be able to have sex with very little, very, very, very little risk. Wow. And what's interesting is you're more likely to contract HIV from a person that doesn't know that they have it versus someone who does have it and is taking the proper measures to prevent the transmission. So this is a really, I mean, I was so excited. I didn't know how deep it was going to get into it. And, you know, when you're in the moment and you're filming it, it wasn't until seeing the whole series that I realized how revolutionary HBO, Michael Lannon, and Andrew Haigh were in including these storylines into the show. Because not only do we get to see how PrEP is used and how they make it work, but we get to see a mixed status couple having sex on TV, and we get to see the HIV positive character Eddie Bear being pursued. You know, it was a lot of things that we haven't seen on television before. So I mean, it's just amazing that I was able to be a part of that in any way, like, you know. PrEP is a tool that people really need to know about. Now, there's a lot of misconceptions about it. People think that you can use it without a condom, and technically you can, but it's less effective. Like, the full effect is when you are completely protected. There's a lot of a misconception that people who use it are more promiscuous than people who don't, which is, like, not the case either. Right. It's a daily pill that you take every day. Much like Propecia, like, or whatever.
Birth control.
And it has a lot of the same stigmas that birth control had, which was discussed in Looking for Gordon Freeman. You know, there was talking about how birth control could liberate women, and there was a lot of things that went around talking about how women were going to be more promiscuous and stuff like that when birth control came on. So it's a lot, the gay community is dealing with a lot of that, but I think straight people need to realize it's for them too. You know, like, it's a big thing now. I totally feel that this drug is so revolutionary and going to help so many people. And along with, like, GLAAD and Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, I talk about it whenever I can. But I honestly feel sometimes when I'm speaking about it now that someone would go back on YouTube and watch this 5 years later, and I'm like, there's this thing called the intranet.
Well, I mean, let's hope.
Right?
That's what happens.
You know, I recently did an appearance on The Doctors. I show The Doctors in support of PrEP and asking Hollywood to create more HIV positive characters in different lights and different situations across TV. And Dr. Rachel on the show asked me, well, you know, as an African-American female, I don't necessarily want to be taking a pill every day for 40 years. And I was, like, in the car on the way home, like, I should have said that if everyone took the pill every day, HIV wouldn't be around for 40 years.
Yeah, it wouldn't last.
So I think that's, like, really important to know, in these news stories that we're telling, what it's like to be a person living with HIV in this age of prevention and treatment, and that we have the tools right now to end HIV by 96%.
Wow.
New infections by 96%. And it's, like, so important just to know that.
Yeah. Yeah.
So look up PrEP. Go to Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation if you have any more questions. You can find out more information there. But it's definitely something to look into.
It's a really interesting part of the show that they can sprinkle in all these really current things.
Oh, yeah.
And do it in a way that it's natural and, like, people are just talking about it.
It never felt forced. It was just always like, this is what's happening. This is what's going on right now.
It's real.
For these people, yeah.
I want to really quickly just touch on Dom and Doris, just because, you know.
They're breaking
up. We love them.
They had a breakup, but it was, like, very sweet. And and Dom has grown just as much as Augustine. I mean, he used to be having sex with, like, little 20-year-olds all across the city and, like, only rolling with those kind of people. And then he met Lynn, and then he's, like, worked on his business, and now here he is. And he's come to terms that he needs to spread his wings and fly and not use Doris's money.
I think that's a hard thing for a guy and girl best friend, like a gay guy. And, you know, like, that's something that a lot of them go through, you know, where they have to actually have that breakup moment. As soon as one of them get a serious relationship, it's like, well, I'm going to go see that movie with this person. Or, you know, I know I have a plus one, but I'm going to take this person. You know, it's a hard separation to have. But, you know, sometimes it could be the relationship could be a crutch, like as it seemed like it was becoming for them.
Yeah.
But they did it so maturely, though. It was very...
After the fact. There was a not-so-great fight.
No, not that. Yeah. But, I mean, the whole wreath talk and, you know.
Yeah, it was very Doris and very Dom.
I love it.
I loved the scene where, Dom went to Malik when he's at work at City Hall. And, like, Malik is all suited up, and I love a man dressed up.
How cute is Malik, by the way?
Oh, my God, I love him.
The sweetest.
I just want to hug him, yeah.
He's perfect for Doris, you know? He's so cute, and she's like, this rough and tough little girl, and then he's just so chill, and he takes her as she is. I love that. And when he's talking on the steps with Dom, Dom says, "Do you love her?" And he goes, "Big time." Yeah. I thought that was, like, the cutest thing. I want a Malik.
Looking for a Malik.
Yes, that's my own spinoff on YouTube. Kylie's looking for Malik. So the thing about this episode was, you know, the side stories were tied up fairly nicely, but then the big Patrick and Kevin was left so open wide that we're all just hanging in for season three, and we don't even know if we'll have it yet. Do you have any idea when?
I mean, I'm fairly confident, you know.
Yeah.
I think people really want it, so.
Yeah. The following has really grown.
Yes.
This season, too. Mm-hmm.
And I think that a lot of that's going to open up even more. You know, a lot of people watch it together in groups. And I think that now that HBO Now is going to be...
Yes.
Most people like to binge watch. They wait for the season to end before they watch it. I mean, I know a lot of people who watch the whole series just in the past few days. Like, you know, now that we finished, all these tweets I'm getting that's like, "I just watched everything." I mean, the first season's 4 hours.
Yeah.
When you put it together.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, that's true.
So really I think short. It's, so I binge watched the first season. I waited till it was over before I saw everything. So I'm imagining that people are going to do that still. But, I mean, we have really diehard fans, so.
When you were cast into the show, how much did you know about your character going into it?
Everything. Well, this was interesting for me. It was they were thinking about me when they were writing it. You know, we met up, and so I met with Andrew Haigh at breakfast, and he was like, "We want you to play this character, Eddie. He's a bear, and he's sexy. So don't worry. Like, it's not, you know." And I was like, "Okay, good." You know, because that was like my next question. I mean, and he was just like, "And we think of him as a love interest for Augustine." And I'm just trying to think if I'm going too far into telling you like about the story. Nobody was like, "And it's going to be complicated. It's not going to be easy. Like, they're going to work through it, and part of that is, you know, he has HIV, but that's not going to be one of the reasons why it's complicated. Like, he's going to be living happy and healthy with HIV." And that, to me, was so progressive. I mean, it hit me like, whoa, because I had recently been doing work, trying to do work with the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, and found out that one of my best friends became PAWS, and was talking to them about how to get him care, and then all of a sudden this role comes up, which is what really led to me feeling like I could magnify my voice and be an ambassador for them. So it all just seemed so serendipitous. And I mean, this, and he told me a little bit about the story. Initially, I was supposed to come in at Rush and River, and like the first time you would see me, I would be swinging on a tire swing into the water at Russian River, and I was like, "Oh, this sounds so cool." You know what I mean? And but there wasn't enough water.
The drought.
Like, actually, that canoe, there's like, it's like 3 feet of water.
Wow.
Like, I was even thinking about, like, should I just walk up to the canoe? That'd be awkward.
We'll try something else.
I was a little bummed to lose the tire swing moment.
Yeah, seriously. That would be awesome. That would have been so cool.
And even that morning, everyone's like, "So you're going to be jumping into the water?" And I was like, "Yes." And then, you know, like, there's no water.
There's no water in California, guys. Really, yeah, it's a problem.
I love telling the story, but that same day, it was bittersweet because Joan Rivers had passed away that same day that we started filming the Russian River scene. And so, but working with all these wonderful people, and I'm excited to start my new role. And we're filming that scene, and I'm standing up on that little hill, and then I turn around, and there's a bunch of naked bears in a circle having a moment of silence for Joan.
Oh my God!
Which I think Joan would find hysterical.
She would love that.
For sure.
She might have prearranged it.
They were like, "Does anyone, there's like bear, like naked and moo-mooed bears, like, anyone want to have a moment of silence with us for Joan?" And then getting in a circle, which I thought was like equal parts hilarious and adorable.
Yes. Wow. That's incredible.
Great way to start the shooting process.
Yeah. God. When I die, can you guys arrange some naked bears in a circle? That would mean a lot.
I have a few numbers.
Thank you. Even if it's just you alone.
It just means one naked bear. The naked bear.
The Eddie bear.
The official.
All right, I could talk to you for hours, but it's getting to be that time. We have to wrap things up. I am so thankful that you came in here to wrap up the season with us. Thank you.
I'm so happy to be here, and thanks everybody for watching.
Yeah.
And if you haven't watched yet and you're going to watch this later, then tweet me. What's up, Danny? Let me know what you think.
Perfect.
And can you tell us also where we can find more Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation information? Can you give us the website?
Yes, you can look up the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, or on Twitter it is ET_AIDS_FDN.
Great.
Perfect. You're like the perfect fit for the ambassador.
Yeah.
Boom. Yeah.
Here you should have like a sash. A little
people
crown.
Listen. Yeah, I should have worn my ribbon.
I love it. Well, thank you again so much for coming in. Kellie, where can everybody find you on the internet?
You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Kellie Knez.
And you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Blake McIver.
Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at the Kylie Hodges, actually Instagram is just at Kylie Hodges. I always forget. Anyways, thank you guys so much for watching. I'm so excited for hopefully a season 3 to come in soon.
Hopefully.
And thank you, Daniel, for coming in.
Yes.
Woo!
Yes.
See you guys next season.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.